Good morning.
Good morning.
If you have a Bible, I encourage you to turn to Matthew chapter 28. The video served two purposes. One is to remind us that as professed believers, we are travelers. We commit ourselves to follow Him, whatever that means. The second thing is that our church is part of the Southern Baptist Convention, and we are involved in missions all over the world. And so we take two national offerings a year. One is at Christmas, and that supports all of the ministries and missions outside of North America, which as a denomination, we fund a little over 5,000 full-time career missionaries outside of North America. At Easter time, we participate in a national offering for missionaries who serve in North America. So starting today, the next 2 weeks, we'll be participating in this, and we just encourage you, if you feel like it's something you want to participate with, go ahead and do that. And there are a number of ways to do that. As a typical church, we'll have an offering at the end of the service. Our offering, we'll tell you up front, is for our members and for those who are committed to be here, those who are guests. And typically on a day like this, we have quite a few. So welcome to all of our guests. It is not for you. If you want to participate, that's fine, but certainly don't feel compelled to in any way. There's another way. We have an exciting announcement to make. Our Beaver Creek Baptist Church app is live today. And we're really excited about that. And now, there are a couple of things, so don't email me, all right? One, they spell the name of the church wrong. Instead of Beaver Creek, it says Beaver Creek. So that's not right. So we have to get them to change that. And then, so it is up, it's live, and we have some updates this week. Now that it's live, there is a blog connected to it that we need to put articles to. The articles that are there now are just general from the company that we're working through. There's also a place for videos that I'll be posting, sermon videos and different kinds of things there as well. Church calendar will be there, though just a number of things will be there. There's also a place for giving, an electronic giving component that we have as a church. That it's through something called PushPay. So if you have the church app, you can click on Give and go through that PushPay app and set up and contribute to whatever you want to do. We also have a way to do that on our church website. So when you go look at the app today, when you download it, if it says, can we give you push notifications? I know how much you love those. Please say yes, because that gives us a chance to send everybody a push notice who has the app saying, hey, don't forget Easter Sunday this week, or we're sorting clothes on Wednesday, or, you know, kind of whatever goes on. So we're excited about that, and we're ready to roll. There are things and events in our lives that happen that change everything. I don't know that a church app is going to change your life and make it, you know, better than it's ever been, but it can't hurt. You know, there are things, we were talking to our kids the other day that I remember, and I'm not that old, I'm just in my early 50s. I remember when airports did not have security. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
And so the airports, when you went to the airport, your whole family went with you to the gate. All the way to the gate, and they're like, hey, come on, come on. And then they can go out. I remember one time getting on the wrong plane. I wish they'd had security at that time. I was pastoring in Indianapolis, and I got on the plane, and the steward says, welcome to your flight to Minneapolis today. Can I get off? So that would have changed my life to be in Minneapolis instead of Indianapolis. There are things that happen. When you have kids in your life, everything changes. It's no longer about you. You become Rebecca's dad. Right? You don't have a name anymore. Dads, right? You don't have names anymore. You're so-and-so's dad, kind of a thing. As believers, as those who study the Bible, we believe that roughly 2,000 years ago, something did happen and changed everything. And I realize if you're here today and you think, well, I don't really do church all that much. It was very interesting when you talk to people about church. And I realize church has a wide spectrum. You may have experienced at some point an extremely traditional kind of church and hellfire, brimstone kind of preaching. That's not me. I only yell at my kids, not at you. Not really all that often. You're due for yelling, aren't you? You're a grown-up now. Yeah, pay rent. But when you look at other stuff, it's like, well, maybe you were in a church sometime, experienced that, you know. I believe all styles of churches are necessary. Some people connect with a traditional church. Some people connect with a very contemporary church. I had somebody this week ask me, how would you describe your church? And I went, we're kind of middle of the road. You know, we're not really contemporary. We're not really traditional. We believe all styles of music can be used to worship the Lord. Just look around how well we dress up today, twice a year. You know, you won't see this many ties and suit jackets next week, I promise you that. I won't be wearing a tie next week. But it's Easter, so we come, we dress up, we look good, and that's okay. So I want to encourage you as guests today, and for all of us that, you know, we come from lots of different backgrounds, but yet there is one God. And that one thing that happened, that God sent Jesus, he was born, he died, and he was resurrected. And today we're starting a three-part series about the event that changed everything. So today's the first part, we've got two the next couple of weeks. And so if you have a Bible, turn to Matthew 28. If you do not have a Bible, the black cover book in front of you next to the hymnals, those are Bibles. Grab one of those, turn to page 527. I even give you the page number. If you do not own a Bible, keep it. It's yours. Seriously, it's yours. We want you to have a Bible. We just continue. I know we're out again. We've given away, I think, 4 cases of Bibles now through this, which I think there are 12, so 4 times 12. Okay. So we've given away about 50 Bibles. Yeah, a little faster over here, all right? We've given away about 50 Bibles in this scene. If you want one, you need one, take it. You know, put your name in it. It's yours to keep. None of them are large print. They're all fairly small. But I'm sure you'd be able to read it. And it's just, God's Word is important. And one of the things I would encourage you to do sometime is maybe you just take one and just read it. Just pick a place. Start somewhere in the middle. We know how it starts. We know how it ends. It's the middle part that's interesting. And just read and see what God has for you. Today we're going to take a look at the day that changed the world, this series, and everything changed starting today. The next couple of weeks I'm going to show you in Scripture, how does it change? How has our lives been impacted in a specific, practical way because of what Jesus did for us? So let's read starting in Matthew 28, and we're going to look at the first 10 verses this morning. It says, after the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. Verse 5, the angel said to the woman, do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here, he has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you. So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. Greetings, he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me. There is a sequence of events that took place. And in case you're not aware of that, let's just touch on that briefly. The sequence basically starts that Jesus was arrested, then he died on Friday. And the question is, how do we know that? When you study Scripture, as far, I can even give you the day he died. April 3rd, A.D. 33. Now, isn't it wonderful? You have such a smart pastor. The doctor is just a paper on the wall. Some say April 7th, A.D. 30, those 2 dates. How do we come to those dates, you might ask? Good question. When you look through the Bible, and you factor in all the things as far as the day Jesus died, it was the day before the Sabbath. The Sabbath is typically Saturday. So sundown Friday till sundown Saturday is the Sabbath. So he died just before that. So that would be on a Friday. When you look at when Caiaphas was high priest, when Quirinius served, and when Caesar, and all these people the Bible talk about when they were serving in capacity, you put all that on a calendar, it comes down to that date, to when Jesus died. Now, I think that's pretty cool. That's not the main point, though. The point was that he did die. And he died for a reason. Saturday, the Sabbath. They were to do no work on the Sabbath, so they couldn't go to the tomb and finish getting the body ready. That's where a lot of our Sabbath or Sunday rules came from. Historically, the Sabbath is Saturday. As Christians, we consider Sabbath, which is not really the Sabbath, to be our Sunday. In the scripture, after all that's happened to Jesus, the scripture says on the first day of the week, they would gather together. So we started as a tradition then, the day that Jesus rose from the dead, the day that the church and the early church started to gather became a Sunday. And so those Sabbath understandings is where on the Sabbath, on Sunday for us, most businesses were closed. You know, Chick-fil-A is still closed on Sunday. You know, Hobby Lobby. Anybody been to the new Hobby Lobby yet? Been there several times. Great store to go to. They're closed today. We have still seen people on Sundays sitting in the Chick-fil-A drive-thru. Hello! Hello! Sure what church they went to, but they're closed. And, yeah, and people might think, well, you know, they could make a lot more money if they would open. I read an article in Fortune magazine that said that Chick-fil-A could increase their revenue by $500 million a year if they were to open just on Sunday. Now, I don't know about you, but I think Chick-fil-A's doing okay. To go through a double drive-thru and wait in line as long as we do for a piece of chicken. Chicken! God's blessing. Jesus died, buried. There were witnesses to the resurrection. In Matthew 28, verse 1, it says, after the Sabbath, on the first day of the week, Sunday, he rose from the dead. Now, the first witnesses to this were the ladies, which is odd. Not that women are odd, but that they would use women as the first witnesses, because at this particular time in history, women weren't given any credibility as being reliable witnesses. So I find it very fascinating when people talk about what the Bible really downgrades women. It really doesn't. The culture at the time may have. But as it started, they used women to be the first ones to say Jesus is risen from the dead really was historically a big deal. And for that to come out, and they came and they gave the witness that Jesus is no longer there. Here's what I want you to think. And I decided to just kind of praying through taking a practical approach to the resurrection today. We can go through all kinds of commentaries and all kinds of places in the gospel. But I want to take kind of you have a brain, right? Use it. It's a good thing. God did not create you not to use your brain. Use it. I want you to think today. Sometimes people say, well, I go to church, it's all about feeling. You check your brain at the door. Well, if you believe that, you're in the wrong place. God gave us a brain. He gave us scripture for a reason. Let's walk through here. And here's the premise. I contend, and based on scripture, something happened. Something happened. It wasn't just business as usual. The resurrection of Jesus, something happened. Let's walk through this. Before the resurrection, the believers, man, they were with Jesus. The disciples, man, they traveled with him. They left their jobs. They left their families. And they followed Jesus wherever he went. Did whatever he wanted them to do. Man, they were there. They followed. Before the death of Jesus, the guards, if you look in Matthew 27, go back to verse 27. In this section, after Jesus was arrested, before he was killed, in Matthew 27, starting in verse 7, then the governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand. Then they knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. And after they had mocked him, they took off the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. Before the death of Jesus, the guards mocked him. After the death of Jesus, Jesus is dead now. He has not been risen from the dead. He's dead. What's happened? Well, if you go to Matthew 27 again in verse 45. Upon the death of Jesus, starting in verse 45, he says, well, this section goes all the way to verse 56. He's on the cross. They give him the sponge. He doesn't take it. Let's go over to verse 54. When the centurion and those with him who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." In the death of Jesus, the soldiers realized that truly this was the Son of God. At the death of Jesus, what about the disciples? These guys, man, they were with him, left their jobs, left everything to follow him. Where were they at? Hiding. Now, before we get on their case too much, what would you do? I mean, human nature. Your leader is dead. And you think, if they can do that to our leader, what could they do to me? See that? Just to give you some reference, we'll not read these, but in Mark 14:50, it says, "Everyone deserted him and fled." Matthew 26:56, "They all deserted him." Luke 23:49 says, "They stood at a distance because they were afraid now." And Luke 24, verse 11, when they said Jesus had risen from the dead, it says they didn't believe Jesus was raised from the dead. If you look at Matthew 27 down in verse 62, towards the end of chapter 27, this is the part where they had to guard the tomb. If you didn't believe that there was any issue with the body of Jesus, then why guard the tomb to start with? At the death of Jesus, things changed. Now, after Jesus was... All right, let's stop for a second. So let's say... what was in this for Jesus? What did he get out of this? You ever thought about that? Okay, I'm the only one, only weird one here. I've wondered this. What did Jesus get out of this? He was obedient to the Father. That was really about it, wasn't it? What benefit would anyone have? Would anybody volunteer today? I've got a hammer. And I've got some gutter spikes. Anybody want to let me nail you to the cross? Max? What do you think, buddy? You want to go in the military? We'll toughen you up. Where? No? Yeah. We just wouldn't do it. There's nothing to gain. It's if there's nothing for Jesus to gain as far as him personally and the humanity, why do it? Did it because of us? There's two parts of Christ, and it's hard for us to comprehend in our mind, but there is the God side and the man side of Jesus. And it's hard to figure out. The scripture teaches that both he was all man, but he was all God, but yet the two existed together. And it's hard in our, the way our minds work. How can it be all of two things? You either are or you're not, right? You're this or you're that. But scripture says he was both. After Jesus was raised from the dead. In Matthew 28, look at verse 11. We're still hanging around that same section, so we should all be right there together. Matthew 28, verse 11 says, "While the women were on their way, some of the guards went to the city and reported to the chief priests everything that happened. When the chief priest had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, 'You are to say, his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble.' So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. There are many who still don't believe in the resurrection of Jesus." If you stop with the death and burial and don't go to the resurrection, then all of the rest of the Bible you can tear out. Because it means nothing without the resurrection of Christ. You say, "Well, I pray. Maybe this is the first time you've been in church a long time. Welcome. We're glad you're here. Hope you feel at home." And you say, "Well, even I don't go to church, I pray. You know, I talk to God and say, 'God, you know, I'm not feeling good today. God, you know, God, I'm married now. What do I do?'" Or one of the times people start coming to churches when they have kids. "I don't know what to do with this, you know." Talking to God, praying for peace, praying to do something with this child, praying and in any regard is pointless if the resurrection did not happen. Because that's where the power comes from. After Jesus is raised to life, the disciples are now bold again. They're not afraid to die any longer. They're not afraid to tell the story of Jesus. Look at Acts for just a moment. So if you're in Matthew, go to the right. Mark, Luke, John, Acts. I forgot to write down what page number that is on the Pew Bible, but it's not very far. It's only about an eighth of an inch. In Acts chapter 4. Now, let's put yourself in Peter and John's place. Following Jesus, life is great. Jesus crucified, he's dead. What am I going to do now? All of a sudden, Jesus is resurrected. He's alive again, like the prophecy says. The disciples are jacked up again. What changed? They saw the resurrected Jesus. Now they're excited. Now they have the whole picture. Because in Matthew chapter 4, starting in verse 1, now the priests and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. They seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. Now drop down to verse 18. Then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, this is great, which is right in God's eyes? To listen to you or to him? You be the judges. As for us, we cannot help but speaking about what we have seen and heard. They have seen Jesus alive, resurrected. They have heard Jesus alive, resurrected. They're ready to get on with it now. And they're not the only ones. I was going to put this list in the bulletin, but I'm just going to name it for you today. After Jesus was raised from the dead and the time that he ascended to heaven in Acts, how many people did he appear to? Here we go. We already talked about the woman at the tomb. He appeared to Mary Magdalene in Matthew 16 and John 20. Two disciples on the road to Emmaus, that's in Mark 16. To Peter, that's in Luke 24 and 1 Corinthians 15. To the 10 disciples in the upper room, that's Luke 24, 36. To the 11 disciples in the upper room again, Mark 16 and John 20. To the 7 disciples fishing, that's in John chapter 21. To the disciples on the Galilee mountain in Matthew 28, 16 and Mark 16, 15. To more than 500 at one time, and we're going to look at this in 1 Corinthians 15 in just a minute. James and all the disciples in 1 Corinthians 15, 7. And at the ascension in Acts 1, 7, 8, 9. He didn't appear to just a couple of people. It wasn't a quiet, you know, kind of backroom kind of thing. Hey guys, I'm here. Over 500 people he appeared to. Now how about that for a witness? See if you can find 1 Corinthians. We're in Acts. Keep going to the right. Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians. 15. Now, for those who like little tidbits, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 2 and 3, I believe it is. Let me check, make sure. No, verses 3 and 4. Are believed to be the oldest confession of faith recorded. Now, through the centuries, churches have developed creeds. You know what a creed is, right? You make a statement of what we believe. We believe in Father, Son, Holy Spirit. You write a creed. There are different kinds of creeds throughout history. This section in verses 3 and 4 historically is believed to have been written within weeks of the resurrection of Jesus. Weeks. And most historians that I could find believe that this was the oldest written, documented confession of faith. Let's start in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. Now, here it is. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to Scriptures. That's the creed, those two verses. Now look at verse 5. And that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom, here listen, most of whom are still living when this was spoken. Though some have fallen asleep, which means they have died. Verse 7. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also as to one abnormally born. He appeared to a whole lot of people after his resurrection. Now, backtrack now. He died. He was put in the tomb. How do we know there was a confirmation that his body was actually put in the tomb? They put the big stone over the door, right? What did they do to the stone? Somebody help me. Did you guys have this in class today? They sealed it. And typically how they would do the king seal in the wax, and they would close something, they would seal it up and put this, only this one ring exists. And so they would put wax or something on it, put the emblem. So as long as that's not broken, whatever was in there, this ring validates that what I put in there is in there. That wasn't broken until Jesus raised from the dead. He was in there, it was validated. Now he's not in there, and he appeared to over 500 people. So if you're trying to say, well, church stuff is only, you know, feeling, just use your brain for a minute. And he followed that process, and he appeared to all of these people. Did it make a difference that Jesus raised from the dead? Absolutely. Everything changed. In the time of Jesus, it changed the lives of the believers. It changed the lives of the ruling religious leaders. It changed the lives of some of the military folks. And it still makes a difference today. Over the next couple of weeks for this series, I'm going to share with you two video testimonies. We do a lot of video stuff from time to time because I'm a visual kind of person and have a short attention span. And so I like having videos to kind of get us focused on things. But two of the videos or the testimonies you're going to see are from folks from our church. And so today I have, we recorded a short testimony about what Jesus means in the life of Joe and Ann Brown. Kind of looking back, I see Steve, but not them today. Are they over there? Oh, there you are. I missed Miss Ann. There she is. She snuck in behind Karen there. And so I met with them this last week and videotaped. This is not all the interview. I made sure she knew I was going to edit it. I won't add any words to you, but I'm going to edit it and make it a little bit shorter. We had about 7 or 8 minutes video that we shot and shortened it up. But here's what I had kind of missed a little bit. How many of you are 43 years old? Well, let's say you're younger than 43. Anybody younger than 43? Well, not me. I mean, under the age of 43. Okay, they joined this church before you were born. They became members here on February 25th, 1973. And they're only 45. Go figure. So I have this is their testimony. It is about 3 minutes long. And parts of it, Roger, you may have to adjust the volume just a little bit. So Joe and Ann Brown.
We were Ann and Joe Brown. We've been a member of Beaver Creek Baptist Church for 40 some years.
Well, could you share just a little bit as far as what the Lord has meant to you for all these years?
Well, you know, and households where our mothers were Baptists, and our fathers nominally so, but our mothers more so. So I learned at a young age that faith was something that carried you through when times were just impossibly hard on the farm or whatever. And it has. I mean, 81 years is a long time. Of course, I would say when I was about 10, I think. And I think the songs of Great Is Thy Faithfulness, speaking of God's faithfulness, not mine, and Because He Lives, have just made all the difference in the world and people understanding what faithfulness is, whether it's personal or church-wide or as a group. And without faith, I don't think I've been married all these years.
How you face life in general, mm-hmm. Because awful things happen. Something happens to one of my kids or grandkids or whoever.
I know one thing. The recent medical problems I've had, here I am on this gurney, and the doctor's there, And I have no fear. If something goes wrong in surgery, my future's secure.
Mm-hmm. We both signed our do not resuscitate things years ago.
Yeah.
I'm going to nail it up on the wall. So it's okay.
But no fear whatsoever. And I'm talking about before surgery. Mm-hmm. And I guess there's always the possibility something go wrong. But just the thought of knowing that that I'm saved and my future's secure, that means so much.
Yeah. Yeah. And you mentioned in your 50s wondering.
Oh, I'm scared to death. I can't die. No.
Things to do.
And people to see, and
great. Any other words of encouragement you might want to give to someone who is trying to wondering about what it means to be a Christian?
Well, it means everything. Your future is secure with the knowledge that you're someday going to go meet Jesus in heaven. So it means a lot to me, just the knowledge that I have that someday I'm going to be leaving this world, but I'll be going to be.
Yes, I cut him off. I'm sorry, Joe. You guys move that on. Sometimes I think what I do here, it's like, well, that's the pastor. That's kind of what he does. You're going to see testimonies from people just like the rest of us. They're in their 80s. Been around for a while, longer than most people here. And they've learned through those 80 plus years that it is a relationship with Jesus that means everything. There are three choices you have today. You might be able to think of some more. I thought of three. When we finish here in just a little bit, you can walk away and go, that was nice, and just go on with your life. That's one option. Another option, you could leave here and at least have started to consider, well, maybe there is something to this. Just maybe. And it's not about how often you're in church or all that other kind of stuff. Would you at least be willing to admit that maybe this is true? Maybe the stuff that you've looked at, maybe the stuff that I share with you today, the stuff that's in Scripture, the stuff you see all over the world, just maybe God is real. And Jesus was real too, and it made a difference. If you're in that place, I would encourage you to go along that path. Keep pursuing that. Learn, what is that? Who is God? We have some things that can help you with that, just some things that you can read. A number of us would be glad to talk to you at some point, but if you're not ready for that, out in the main lobby here, we have an information table that has some little booklets about what am I here for? What's the purpose of my life? Grab one, take it with you. The other option is that you're at a place today to say, you know what? I believe the Bible's true. I believe God is real, that Jesus came. And your next step is what the Bible says would be number one, to repent. And we have a hard time with that. We have a hard time with that. I remember for a time growing up watching Happy Days. Anybody remember watching Happy Days? Go back and watch it now and go, that was kind of dumb. But at the time, that was really good. You know, I grew up watching Happy Days, All in the Family, you know, MASH, WKRP in Cincinnati, that kind of quality television. And I remember watching Happy Days, and whenever the Fonz, the main character, would do something that wasn't right, he could never say he was wrong. You remember that? He would go, I was... You were what? Oh, I was... No, you are wrong. That's where we struggle. Maybe there was a time, but I can't think there were very many times that my kids did something, or even I did something that I shouldn't have, that I went to my mom and said, hey mom, I was wrong. Usually our approach is, I was wrong, but you have to catch me first. Right? I wasn't wrong if I don't get caught. Kind of a deal. We look at Scripture when it talks about to say to acknowledge that God is God, that His Son came, and because of His sacrifice and resurrection, now I can be forgiven of my sins. We have to admit to God that I have sinned. That's the first step. That's what the Bible says. I have to confess. I have to repent. And believe in Jesus as the Son of God and my Savior. We have that confession of faith. So I'm not sure where you are today. Only you know where you are. If you're on the journey, I encourage you to come back next week. And just continue, at least for the next couple of weeks of this series. If you get through the 3 weeks and go, that was nice. Then it was good to meet you. But if it's like, I want to know some more, then keep coming. We're not going to pressure you. We just want you to know. For those who might be here today saying, you know, I think today, it's time. You guys are interesting, the older we get and the older y'all get. When we start, we're young, we can do anything, right? We can do anything. It doesn't matter what it is. We can fix it. And our wives are like, don't you need instructions? No, real men don't read instructions. It's already broke. How can I make it any broker? I've actually said those words before. You know, I can do this. You know, you're out with some of your friends. I remember summers with some of my friends, and we were in Tennessee water skiing. Unattended, bad move. They said, hey, can you ski on one ski? I don't know. Let's find out. Can you ski with no skis? I don't know. Let's find out. I did it briefly. Then I skied on my face. Now, if I could get video testimonies of some of you looking at me like, I've never done anything like that before in my life. Liar. Yes, you have. We all have. I can do this. The older we get, we start to realize that may not have been a good idea. We get to the point now, you get to a certain point in life and go, you know what, if I could go back and do it all again, knowing what I know now, I wouldn't make any mistakes. Yes, you would. We just make different mistakes, right? We'll fix those, but then we just make different mistakes. Listen, this is not, we look at this. It's not about, I need to repent of my sins, I'm going to follow Christ, and then I'm going to be perfect. Then my life is going to be perfect. Then all of my problems are going to be over. Then I'm going to have all the money I ever want, I'm going to have the car that I want, I'm going to pray today, and bang, I'm going to have this new vet sitting in the parking lot. If there's a new vet in the parking lot, it's mine. Because while somebody else is praying, I'm going to the parking lot first. You think, oh yeah, that's what's going to happen. Or you know, my grades, all of a sudden, I'm going to get straight A's and more scholarships and I know what to do with. Okay, you're missing the point. When we repent of our sins and we go to God and say, God, I want to follow you. Now it becomes, as a believer, following Christ, there are things that come along with that. In your relationships that may not be going so well, as a Christian, we say, okay, God, how do you want me to be in this relationship? What kind of person should I be to my kids? What kind of person should I be to my spouse or to my girlfriend or to my boyfriend? God, how should we live? If you're a dating couple and you're even thinking about getting married, you know, should you be living together? Should we be having sex? Should we be, you know, what does this relationship look like? God gives directions for all of that. If you say, well, what career should I choose? Does it really matter either way? I think there's some clear-cut jobs that as Christians we probably shouldn't have. You can fill in the blanks. What it means is then I commit myself and my life to follow Christ, to represent Him. Because here's the thing. I could live in the smallest, dumpiest house in town. Have the junkiest little car. You remember those cars you used to have? I had a car you used to have to start with a screwdriver. Remember that?
Yeah.
We were in seminary, had this old car, and it would get a dead spot in the starter. It had a long screwdriver that had to bend. So I'm getting off work at 1 or 2 in the morning, going outside, and it starts. It's like, God, can't you do better than this? Of course, I only paid $100 for the car, so I can't complain. It becomes, okay, God, I have a car. I like one that would start with a key, but at least I have a car and get to work. God, I got a place to live. Most of you here I know, you have food. Most of the time we say, hey babe, there's nothing here to eat. Or we're hanging on the refrigerator doors. Usually means there's nothing I want. but there's generally food in the fridge. We're a blessed people. What difference makes is the food I do have, I'm thankful for. The time I don't have really what I want, I'm thankful for that too. See the change? The big change is this. When the day comes that this body gives out and I die, I get to be with God. Listen, to me,